Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Most Beneficent, the Most Merciful. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the Worlds. I ask Allah to have His salah, the mentioning of the Prophet Muhammad's name at the most high place in heaven, and the peace of Allah be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah to make me better than they think about me. Allahumma ij'alni khayran mimma yadhunnun waghfir li ma la ya'lamun. And I ask him to forgive me for the things that you don't know about me. I'm very glad to be with you here in Ad-Dammam. Fajazakum Allahu khayr for inviting me. A word of correction. When I left Lebanon, a Muslim does not migrate to a kafir land, but the migration, the hijrah, is only to a Muslim land. So my travel from Lebanon to the United States was not a migration, because migration only could be to the Muslim land. You know that the nature in man, the nature itself in man, normally recognizes what is good and what is bad, what is true and what is false. And part of this recognition is that it recognizes that the attributes of God, Allah, must be true, and that they must be unique and all perfect. This is something of the innate nature in man itself. It does not accept any degradation of the attributes of the most perfect of God, Allah. And it does not relax towards any kind of degradation of these attributes. Many people who became discontent with God did that because of many reasons, amongst misconceptions about Allah, and then too much devotion to materialistic life. They fled the concept of turning to God, to Allah, and they ran into the dwellings of money and habitations of desire. With the advancement of technology in this materialistic world around us, many from different religions forgot or decided to forget about God totally. And they put a banner to themselves saying, let us live this life and enjoy it. They didn't really think about what comes next, because that thing is irrelevant. What matters is, make it. Let's make it now. And they revive the old god of Rome, and that is the god of desire. And they escape, and they try and continue to try to escape the complexities of their materialistic life nowadays through various means. And many of them, believe me, are coming back to search again about themselves. They went through a vicious cycle, and now they're coming to search. Many of them, we have seen them going from a church to a church to a church, or from a sect to a sect to a sect. We have seen this in many parts of the world. But those who examined the Quran and examined Islam, they found for themselves the complete code of life that they needed. The nourishment of the soul and to the attachment to the most valuable thing that they were looking for, and that is the truth. That is so precious deep inside themselves. Their innate nature was rusted. Rust came on it, because originally they were born Muslims, meaning they were born on fitrah, which means they naturally submitted to their creator. But then the rust came, and the rust came from the environment, mainly the parents, as we will see later in one saying of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Each child is born on fitrah, and it's its parents who turn him Christian, a Jew, or a Magian. The Creator Allah has perfect attributes. He is the first. He is the last. He is the ever living. He does not beget, nor is he begotten. Those who attribute divinity to other than God, and mostly those who attribute it to Jesus, forget or ignore the fact that Jesus was in a mother's womb, that he needed nutrition, that he was born and became a man. A man who needs to eat, walk, sleep, rest, respond to the call of nature. Such qualities and such attributes, in no way it represents divinity. In no way it represents godhood. In no way. Let's not go through complexities about this subject. We want to go very simple to the people and address them on these simple facts. A man walking the streets, eating the food, drinking, responding to the call of nature, you give him divine attributes and you worship him, something is seriously wrong. We need to re-examine our stand. Therefore, what we want to concentrate on is the attributes. All these gods with small g that these people had made, if you carefully look at them, you will find that they all are in need of something. And anyone who is in need is deficient in self needs. Therefore, he is not self-sufficient. And the nature itself, the innate nature, accepts the self-sufficient, accepts perfectness. And this could only be to God, to Allah. We look at Buddhism, Hinduism, and many isms. They all worship creation in one form or another. Whom you want to name? Buddha, man, created. Needs to eat, needs to walk. Take it to that criteria. Huh? Just take it to that criteria, you'll take divinity out of him. The Jews had attributed a nationalistic attribute to Allah. They labeled him the tribal god of the children of Israel. Now we see that men and women who follow these religions and who were born on the natural inclination of submitting to their creator, which is Islam, and that's the meaning of Islam, we see them, as I said earlier, questioning many things about this dogma that they lived with for years. And a testimony for what I say now is the fact that I see you here. Your mere presence here is a strong evidence for the search process, for the questions that were one day between the two hands of the parents, taking you to church, hallelujah, hallelujah, put money with the priest, huh? Think that he's the one who forgives the sins. Just go over this, huh? Put the imaging now in front of you. Get the movie going, huh? In your brains. And you will remember what it was. Allah is ever living, all hearer, all seer. No created being has these qualities. None. You and I exist, and the world around us exists. And the one who controls what exists is ever living, cannot die. Allah says in the Quran, أَفِي اللَّهِ شَكٌ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. In Surah Ibrahim, Ayah 10, verse 10, is there a doubt about Allah, God, the creator of the heavens and the earth? This is in the Quran, Surah 14, chapter 14, Ayah 10. And for those who have a pencil or a pen, this is a chance for them to get it working and have these evidences and go back to the Quran and look at them. There is no doubt, because in the heavens and the earth there are signs. There are signs to testify that the Creator is true and He is perfect. Listen to what Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَآيَاتٍ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Truly, in the heavens and the earth, there are signs for the believers. This is in the Quran, Surah Al-Jathiyah, Surah 45, Ayah 3. All that surrounds us testify to the fact that creation did not come up of nothing or from nothing. Because nothing does not exist. A non-existence lacks the ability to create. Man can make the electric bulb that you see. He can make the car, etc. Those things produced by man reflect some of the abilities and qualities of man. Many things came to existence and still are coming to existence every day. These things function in a sophisticated or in sophisticated ways. There must be a unique, ever-living being who is able, all-wise, all-knowing, and all-perfect. And this, as will be proven to you, is God, Allah. Listen to this beautiful verse, ayah of the Quran. If you have gold, write it with gold. It is in Surah At-Tur, Surah 52, ayah 35 and 36. أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بَلْ لَا يُوقِنُونَ. Were they created by nothing? Or were they themselves the creators? Questions. Or did they create the heavens and the earth? Nay, but they have no firm belief. Those who deny and those who reject, they have no firm belief. They were not created from nothing. They themselves were not the creators. They did not create others. They did not create the heavens and the earth. And the universe could not have created itself, nor did it come about by chance from nothing. Everything created is in need of the one and only one creator who created it, and that is Allah, most exalted. He is not part of a creation. He is distinct from creation. Creation is in need of Him. He is not in need of anything, including creation. And He is different in Himself as well as in His attributes from all that which He creates. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. In Surah Ash-Shura, Ayah 11, Surah 42, Ayah 11. There is nothing like unto Him, and He is the All-Hearer, the All-Seer. There can be no more than one God for this whole universe. Imagine what will happen to the universe had there been more than one God. We leave it to Allah in the Quran to tell us about this. He says in Surah Al-Anbiya, which is Surah 21 and Ayah 22, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَفَسَدَتَا فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَرْشِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. Had there been therein, meaning in the heavens and the earth, gods besides Allah, then verily both would have been ruined. Glorified be Allah, the Rabb of the Arsh, of the throne. High is He above what they attribute to Him. And remember, we use the word Rabb still in the translation, because we want to distinguish it from the word Lord, which many have been used to. Because the word Rabb, Allah is the Rabb, is the attribute, is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who gives all things the power to grow, to move, and to change, and to whom belongs the creation and commandment. The master who has no equal in his sovereignty, in his predominance, in his highness. The one who provides and sustains all that exists. This is the meaning of Ar-Rabb. So, if such deities differ, these alleged deities, he first said that the heavens and the earth will be spoiled had there been more than one God. Of course. Who's going to set the sun today? Who's going to set the moon tomorrow? Difference, huh? Power struggle. In fact, he referred to this in the Quran, saying, قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ مَعَهُ آلِهَةٌ كَمَا يَقُولُونَ إِذَنْ لَبْتَغَوْا إِذَا دِلْعَرْشِ سَبِيلًا. Say, O Muhammad, to the disbelievers, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if there had been other gods along with him, with Allah, as they assert, then they would certainly have sought out a way to the Rabb of the Arsh, of the throne. Yeah. You know what is this called in our modern terms? They will make what is called coup d'etat. Coup d'etat. You know? Power struggle. Taking over. Plots. Certainly not. There can be only one God for all of this universe. And His name is Allah. And Allah means, comes from the root Ilah. Al-Ilah. The true Ilah that deserves to be worshipped alone. The true God that deserves to be worshipped alone. Allah. Allah the Creator must be eternal. He is the first. Nothing before Him, or nothing is before Him. Remember this. He is the first. Anything before in your mind, anything before goes back to Him. Because He is what? The first. He encompasses everything that was before, not before Him. Because He is the first. He is the last. He is the last. He encompasses everything that comes after. But after Him? After Him? Answer. Is there thing after Him? Anything after Him? No. He encompasses anything in your mind that is after. Let me come up to you. He encompasses everything that is after, but not after Him, because He is the last. So, everything ends up to Him. He is the last. Nothing is first, but Allah is before it. Araf? Nothing is first, but Allah is before it. Nothing is last, but Allah is after it. He is self-sufficient. He cannot be caused. Nothing outside Him causes Him to continue to exist. You understand? He cannot be caused. Nothing outside Him causes Him to continue to exist. He does not need anyone or anything. He does not need a son. He does not need a wife. He does not need a daughter. He doesn't need anything or anyone to do for Him anything. He is everlasting. He does not die and does not vanish. In all of His attributes, He is perfect, absolute, and nothing is like unto Him. Read Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah 112, Ayah 1-4. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. Say, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He is Allah, the One, the self-sufficient Master, whom all creatures need. This is the meaning of As-Samad. Okay? This is the meaning of what? As-Samad. The One, self-sufficient Master, whom all creation needs. He begets not, nor was he begotten, and there is none like unto him. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, most glorified he is. Allah is most high, and Allah is most near. He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, most glorified, is above everything by himself, and nothing is above him. He arose above his arsh, his throne, in a unique way that best fits his majesty and glory. And he is distinct from us. We don't see him. But he sees everything from above high on his arsh. He is not in person, in himself meaning everywhere. You cannot say he is under this. Can you? So he is not everywhere in the sense that everywhere means by himself. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses anything everywhere in his knowledge, in his encompassing, in his acquaintance, and in his control. Nothing escapes him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about this in the Quran, in Surah Yunus. In 7 verses in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells about himself that he is most high, he is above the arsh, he is above the heavens. إِنَّ رَبَّكُمُ اللَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ. In Surah Yunus, Surah 10, Ayah 3. Your Rabb is Allah, who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Huh? In 6 days. And then arose above his arsh. Remember, he didn't say here and he rested on the seventh. Did he? Is this a quality of a perfect God? Of the perfect God? To rest and get tired? And he manages all things. And as he says also in Surah Al-An'am, Surah 6, Ayah 18. وَهُوَ الْقَاهِرُ فَوْقَ عِبَادِهِ وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. He is irresistible above his slaves. And he is all wise, well acquainted with what? With all things. And to him ascends all the good deeds and all the good works. إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. In Surah Fatir, which is Surah 35, and Ayah 10, to him ascends the goodly words and all the righteous deeds he lifts up to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is not in everything. Remember this. Allah is not in everything, and everything is not in himself. Why? Because some people think or may say that Allah is in his creation, is united with everything that he created. This is a degradation of his attributes. All of his creation is in need, as we thought and we think and we believe. So how do you want Allah to be in everything, united with something deficient? He is most high and does not dwell in his creation. Does not dwell in his creation. He is not in Jesus. Okay? He is not in Jesus. He is not in any righteous man. He is not in Ghandi. He is not in Nelson Mandela. He is not in Khomeini. You know what? He is not in Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Allah is above his creation, yet he encompasses everything to the degree that he is closer to a thing more than the thing to itself. In his knowledge, in his acquaintance. and nothing beyond him, beyond his knowledge, beyond his reach, and beyond his closeness. The sincere believer who calls upon Allah, Allah is close to him. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يُرْشَدُونَ. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah 2, Ayah 186, when my slaves ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, concerning me, then I am indeed near, meaning near to them by my knowledge. I respond to the dua, to the invocations of the supplicant when he calls on me without any mediator or an intercessor. So let them obey me and believe in me so they may be led right. Surah 2, Ayah 186. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who does not speak from his own self, who is inspired from Allah, says about Allah the following descriptions and qualities. He says, وَأَنْتَ الظَّاهِرُ فَلَيْسَ فَوْقَكَ شَيْءٍ وَأَنْتَ الْبَاطِنُ فَلَيْسَ دُونَكَ شَيْءٍ. This is part from an authentic hadith related by Imam Muslim. The translation of the meaning: you, Allah, are the most high. Nothing is above you. And you are the most near. Nothing is beyond you, meaning beyond you in reach. Being the most high and the most near tells us that Allah encompasses everything that is manifest, and everything also that is hidden. For there is nothing that is manifest, but Allah is above it. And nothing that is hidden, except that Allah is close and near to it. And that the hidden to him is manifested. Remember this. The hidden to him is manifested. And everything that is manifested, he is high above it. And to him is the final return. وَإِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. In Surah Al-Najm, Ayah 42, Surah 53. Your Rabb, to your Rabb Allah, is the final return. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to examine His signs and look at them. Look at them in ourselves as well as in the universe that surrounds us, and to witness the coming of these signs in the horizon as they come and be manifested, so that people come close to the truth and contemplate about these signs, so that they know who deserves to be worshipped alone. One single sign in ourselves, which is the manifestation of Allah's creation, is the development of us inside our mother's womb. How did we develop? Many people know that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was unlettered, right? He didn't know how to read. It is certain that he did not know any kind of microscopy. Huh? You know what's microscopy? He did not know electron microscopy, of all these new terminology that you hear about, fluorescence microscopy, nuclear magnetic resonance imaging, you name it, huh? All these imaging scopy stuff, he didn't know anything about, right? He didn't know anything about it. They use these tools nowadays to follow the development of the embryo, right? Inside the mother's womb. And they tell you, to a great deal of truth, his stages of development. Now, 1400 years or more ago, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't have any of these means. And he didn't open the belly of any woman to look how the fertilized egg develops to be a human, completed after 9 months. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَحْنُ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ فَلَوْلَا تُصَدِّقُونَ أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تُمْنُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ تَخْلُقُونَهُ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْخَالِقُونَ. We created you, then why do you believe not? Then tell me about the human semen that you emit. Is it you who created, make it into a human being? or we the creator? Allah says about Himself, we. We? You Muslims say that Allah is one, and now He says about Himself, we. And the Christians had said, three in one, one in three. So where do you go with this we? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Himself in all matters of glorification relating to His acts, related to His power, related to His ability to create, refers to Himself by we. نحن. He says نحن. This is, by the way, not strange at all in the Arabic language or in the Semitic languages that people spoke in the in this area. In fact, a monarch, a normal monarch, a king or so, when he issues a statement, he uses the word what? Or he says about himself, we issue the following decree, right? He's trying to give himself a status, right? But he is how many people? How many? One, okay? So, this fits to the being who is created. To Allah, it is more perfect. And to Allah is the best parable. You see, the English, they use it too. The English, they use it too. You know, when lady, what's her name? The English queen, steps up to give a royal statement. She says, we in the, we in the, right? So this is a term of glorification. So beings who are created and weak use it. Allah, the creator, the all-able, the perfect, to Him belongs the best example. So it is not three in one, ten in one, or what? We for glorification, right? But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls people to worship Him, He says, worship what? Me. Worship? Me alone. You understand? Right. So because sometimes many people ask about this when they read the Quran and they come across it and they don't understand. And some confusion and shaitan, the devil, comes to whisper in them and saying, oh, this is... So be careful. Now we read in the most respected books that came out from medical schools or for to teach medical students who go to medical schools. A book by a famous embryological or a famous OBGYN, they call it, professor of embryology, obstetric and gynecology, by the name of Keith Moore, published a book in 1988 edition. He speaks about the development of the human embryo. You know what he cites as reference? He cites the Quran as reference. He cites the Quran as reference. And gives you, in the history of development of the human embryo, he gives you statements, and I have the quotations and the paper and where exactly where it is quoted. The book is called Introduction to Embryology, 1988 edition. It's a medical textbook in many medical schools in the West and other places. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِّنَ الْبَعْثِ فَإِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِّن تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ مِّن نُطْفَةٍ ثم من علقة ثم من مضغة مخلقة وغير مخلقة ولنبين لكم ونقر في الأرحام ما نشاء إلى أجل مسمى ثم نخرجكم طفلا ثم لتبلغوا أشدكم ومنكم من يتوفى ومنكم من يرد إلى أرض العمر لكي لا يعلم من بعد لكي لا يعلم بعد علم أو من بعد علم شيئا. In Surah Al-Hajj, Surah 22, Ayah 5. Please write it down and go and read it. The translation of the meaning. O mankind, if you are in doubt about the resurrection, then verily we have created you from dust, referring to Adam. Then from a nutfa, which is mixed drop of male and female sexual discharges. And this is a refer to the offspring of Adam. Then from a clot, a piece of thick coagulated blood. Then from a little lump of flesh, some formed and some unformed, referring to miscarriages that occur. That we may make it clear for you, meaning to show our power and our ability to do what we will. And we cause whom we will to remain in the wombs for an appointed term. then we bring you out as infants, then give you growth, that you may reach your age of full strength. And among you there is he who dies young, and among you there is he who is brought back to the miserable old age, so that he knows nothing after having known. This is the development of us. This is how we came in stages inside the womb. All these sciences now explain what the Quran explained 1400 plus years ago. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't know all or nothing of this technology. Subhanallah. But man was not left neglected. And this is part of the attribute of his creator, of Allah, the All-Merciful, saying, أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. Does man think that he will be left neglected? Then he reminds him about his creation, so that he doesn't become arrogant. He forgets where he came from between filth and blood. That's where we came from, isn't it? From between filth and blood. So why we just shoot up our heads and walk high and think, you know, we master the earth, or it's okay, I will just live this life and enjoy it, make more money. أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. أَلَمْ يَكُ نُطْفَةً. Look at the reminder. أَلَمْ يَكُ نُطْفَةً مِنْ مَنِيٍ يُمْنَى. Was not he a nutfa, which is the mixed male and female discharge of semen. ثُمَّ كَانَ عَلَقَةً فَخَلَقَ فَسَوَّى. Then he tells you about his development. Then he became a alaqa, which is a clot. Then Allah shaped and fashioned him in due proportion. فَجَعَلَ مِنْهُ الزَّوْجَيْنِ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى. Then he made of him two sexes, male and female. Is not he, Allah, who does that, able to give life to the dead? Yes, he is able to give, to do all what he wants. This is in Surah Al-Qiyamah, which is Surah 75, Ayah 36 up to Ayah 40. So he was not left neglected, man, you and us. We're examining the signs in ourselves. Now, we didn't even move to look at the universe. We're just looking about ourselves. So we better humble ourselves to our Creator and submit to Him and accept Him and accept His command. Man is in constant struggle in this life, and Allah, His Creator, tells him about this. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ أَيَحْسَبُ أَنْ لَنْ يَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ أَحَدٍ يَقُولُ أَهْلَكْتُ مَالًا لُبَدًا أَيَحْسَبُ أَنْ لَمْ يَرَهُ أَحَدٍ أَلَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَيْنَيْنِ وَلِسَانًا وَشَفَتَيْنِ وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. Verily we have created man in toil, in strong, constant struggle in this life. Thinks he, man, that none can overcome him? Sometimes, you know, you walk the street, think, nobody can overcome me. Strong. But you know what? We don't even owe the air we breathe. If something happens to this atmosphere around us, we may suffocate, right? He says, man, boastfully, I have destroyed wealth in abundance. Thinks he, man, that none sees him? Have we not made for him a pair of eyes and a tongue and a pair of lips and shown him the two ways, good and evil? This is in Surah 90 in the Quran, Ayah 6 to 8. Then so that man doesn't speak highly about himself and ascribe purity to himself, another reminder. إِذْ أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَأَنْتُمْ وَإِذْ أَنْتُمْ أَجِنَّةٌ فِي بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنْفُسَكُمْ هو أعلم بمن اتقى. In Surah Al-Najm, in Surah 53, verse 32, He knows you well when He created you from the earth, referring to Adam, and when you were fetuses in your mother's wombs. So, what's the message? The message is here. So ascribe not purity to yourselves. Don't ascribe purity to yourself. He knows best him who fears Allah and keep his duty to him. And for those who deny, beautiful reminders and mercy from the one who created them. يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ فِي أَيِّ صُورَةٍ مَا شَاءَ رَكَّبَ. O man, what has made you careless concerning your Rabb? Do you reflect on these words? Are you reflecting? If you feel tired and everything, try to relax. And if you feel like tired because you work the whole of the day and you feel to sleep, try to change your place. Or go wash your face. What has made you careless concerning your Rabb, O man? The most generous who created you. You see between these lines what you are reading? Aren't you reading about the attributes of Allah? Aren't you? He's telling you to know him and know his attributes. Because you are not going to worship him right without knowing him first. The most generous who created you, fashioned you perfectly and gave you due proportion in whatever he will, he put you together. Nay, but you deny the recompense. You are arrogant. You deny the recompense? قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَهُ مِنْ أَيِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ خَلَقَهُ فَقَدَّرَهُ ثُمَّ السَّبِيلَ يَسَّرَهُ ثُمَّ أَمَاتَهُ فَأَقْبَرَهُ ثُمَّ إِذَا شَاءَ أَنْشَرَهُ كَلَّا لَمَّا يَقْضِ مَا أَمَرَ. In Surah Abasa, Surah 80, verses 17 to 23, again to the arrogant man. Be cursed the disbelieving man. How ungrateful he is. How ungrateful he is. From what thing did he create him? From nutfa he created him. Then set him in due proportions. Then he makes the path easy for him. Then he causes him to die and puts him in his grave. Then when it is his will, he will resurrect him again. Nay, but man does not do what Allah commanded him to do. And how easily he forgets. We eat, we drink, and then we go to the earth there, out there, plant it. We get the grains. We see the gardens. We take the grapes, the fruits that you see from all countries, which represent the earth that we live on, and the cattle we have, and the milk we drink. And then when you eat, if you try to remember this, remember this verse in Surah 80, which is the same surah that was cited earlier. Surah 80, verses 24 to 32. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ أَنَّا صَبَبْنَا الْمَاءَ صَبَّا ثُمَّ شَقَقْنَا الْأَرْضَ شَقَّا فَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا حَبَّا وَعِنَبًا وَقَضْبًا وَزَيْتُونًا وَنَخْلًا وَحَدَائِقَ غُلْبًا وَفَاكِهَةً وَأَبَّا مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِأَنْعَامِكُمْ. Then let man look at his food when you go have lunch, whether it's riz Bukhari or chicken. Think about it. Or fish. Then let man look at his food, that we pour forth water in abundance, and we split the earth in clefts. We cause therein the grain to grow, and grapes and clover plants, and olives and date palms, and gardens dense with many trees and fruits and herbage, to be a provision and benefit for you and your cattle. And your cattle. And then we came out from our mother's womb. We think we knew everything about the world and, all knowledgeable, we thought. وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. In Surah 16, Ayah 78, and Allah has brought you out from the wombs of your mothers while you know everything? Huh? Everything? Or what? Let's hear it strongly, loudly. Huh? Nothing. While you know nothing, and He gave you hearing, sight, and hearts that you may thank. Thank whom? Allah. And how we thank Him? Submitting to Him in Islam, in worship, in obedience. So man forgets. But while he's taking a jet home, suddenly the captain says, two engines stopped. The fourth is on fire. Huh? The third fell down. And he's in a jet going home. What do you think he will say? What he's going to think about? What he's going to say? You know, the atheist, starting with the atheist first. What do you think the atheist will say? Huh? Yeah, don't be shy, say it. He will say, oh my God. But then, you know, it's not time for his death. The plane lands safely, the engines work. And he comes down. Huh? And he forgets everything. Isn't it? وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانُ ضُرٌّ دَعَى رَبَّهُ مُنِيبًا إِلَيْهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا خَوَّلَهُ نِعْمَةً مِنْهُ نَسِيَ مَا كَانَ يَدْعُو إِلَيْهِ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَجَعَلَ لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ قُلْ تَمَتَّعْ بِكُفْرِكَ قَلِيلًا إِنَّكَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّارِ. In Surah Az-Zumar, which is Surah 39, Ayah 8. And when some hurt touches man, he cries to his Rabb, to Allah alone, turning to Him in repentance. But when He bestows a favor upon him from Himself, he forgets that for which he cried for before. And he sets up rivals to Allah. Then he will walk to the church, huh? And go say to the priest, oh, I was in trouble, priest. Huh? Try be intercessor between me and God. Thank Him for me, huh? He sets up rivals to Allah in order to mislead others from His path. Say, for those, take pleasure in your belief for a while. Surely you are one of the dwellers of the fire of hell. If he dies on that, and he dies on the rejection of Allah, he will be from the dwellers of fire of hell. And Allah is all just in that. He gave him everything, created him, gave him the sight, gave him the hearing, gave him the fruits, gave him everything around him. Huh? And then what? He turns away from him. He turns his back to him. Turns away. Huh? What kind of a thank he is giving to his Creator? And he chooses what? He chooses people who will die like him and worship them. Or call upon them. Or go to their graves and touch their graves and think they will benefit them or harm them. Huh? Or their tombs. But look. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ سَمْعَكُمْ وَأَبْصَارَكُمْ وَخَتَمَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِهِ أُنظُرْ كَيْفَ نُصَرِّفُ الْآيَاتِ ثُمَّ هُمْ يَصْدِفُونَ. In Surah 6, Ayah 46, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the disbelievers, tell me if Allah took away your hearing and your sight, which He already gave to you, right? And sealed up your hearts. Who is there a God other than Allah could restore them to you? Look how variously we explain the signs, proofs, evidences, verses, lessons, signs, revelations, all these called signs. But they turn aside. Not only that, we rest during the day sometimes, and we work most of the day, right? And we rest all or most of what? The night. What will happen if Allah makes the day prevail continuously? Allahu Akbar. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ النَّهَارَ سَرْمَدًا إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِضِيَاءٍ أَفَلَا تَسْمَعُونَ. Say, O Muhammad, to the disbelievers. Muhammad is carrying a message, is the Quran. Say to them, tell me, if Allah made the night continuous for you till the day of resurrection, who is God besides Allah who could bring you light? Will you not then hear? This is in Surah 28, Ayah 71. 28, Ayah 71. قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ النَّهَارَ سَرْمَدًا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِلَيْلٍ تسكنون فيه أفلا تبصرون. Quran 28:72. Say, O Muhammad, to the disbelievers, tell me, if Allah made the day continuous for you till the day of the resurrection, who is a God besides Allah who could bring you night wherein you rest? Will you then not listen, not see? Could you bring life to these trees that you plant? You have no ability to cause the growth of the trees of your gardens. Is there any God with Allah? مَا كَانَ لَكُمْ أَن تُنْبِتُوا شَجَرَهَا أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ بَلْ هُمْ قَوْمٌ يَعْدِلُونَ. But there are people who ascribe equals to him, and they turn to them and seek help from them. أَمَّنْ جَعَلَ الْأَرْضَ قَرَارًا. This earth that we are living on, and the rivers that we see around us. But you see, most of the times we fly and see these things and we take them for granted. Huh? We take them for granted. We don't really contemplate. We don't contemplate. By Allah, when I flew from Riyadh today to this city, soon after the plane took off, I was expecting, you know, full sand. And indeed, I started looking down to see the sand. And suddenly in the midst of this sand, and you can see it, if you take a flight from there, coming to Dammam, just look for my word there and see for yourself. A valley stretching miles and miles and miles in the desert itself, with trees, green, stretching for miles in a narrow path between hills. Allahu Akbar. And we take it for granted. Where? How come? And also, we don't even think this is a salty Atlantic Ocean, huh? And this is a Mediterranean Sea with different degrees of saltiness, huh? Between the two. Why they don't overtake each other? Why don't one with, you know, with a lesser density floats, and the other with greater density, you know, goes in and lifts the other up, huh? How come? How come we see the fresh water going miles and miles in the sea? If you go to the Nile River, you go to the Mississippi, you go to whatever a major river in your countries, and you look down there where it goes and pours the water, you see it going for some kilometers and miles, right? Distinct. Certainly Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't know anything about surface tension of water, specific gravity of water, did he? أَمَّنْ جَعَلَ الْأَرْضَ قَرَارًا وَجَعَلَ خِلَالَهَا أَنْهَارًا وَجَعَلَ لَهَا رَوَاسِيَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ حَاجِزًا أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Is not he better than your God, who has made the earth as a fixed abode, and has placed rivers in its midst, and has placed firm mountains therein, and has set a barrier between the two seas of salt and sweet water. Is there any God with Allah? There is a partition between these waters. Partition. A real partition, but you don't see it. It's there. It's physical and it's there, but you don't see it. And each supports a distinct system of life within it. And then also we took for granted many things. أَمَّنْ يَهْدِيكُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَنْ يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَيِّ رَحْمَتِهِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Is not he better than your gods, who guides you in the darkness of the land and sea, and who sends the winds as heralds of glad tidings, bringing the rain, and bringing with it therefore the good things? Is there any God with Allah? High exalted be Allah above what they attribute to him. And we live and we die. And then we will brought back on the day of resurrection. And provisions come to us from the heavens and from the earth. And with all the evidences that Allah cited in the Quran, there comes one more. أَمَّنْ يَبْدَأُ الْخَلْقَ ثُمَّ يُعِيدُ وَمَنْ يَرْزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Is not he better than your so-called gods, who originates creation and shall thereafter repeat it, and who provides for you from heaven and earth? Is there any God with Allah? Say, O Muhammad, to them, and bring your proofs if you are truthful. Bring your proofs if you are truthful. And this is in man and what surrounds man, some of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is more and more. More and more in the universe. But we take it for granted. And we look at the stars and see them and try to count them and, you know, do everything except thinking about why they are there, who put them there, etc. This we are putting it in the back of our minds. Who set the stars and why? وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ النُّجُومَ لِتَهْتَدُوا بِهَا فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ قَدْ فَصَّلْنَا الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ. It is He, Allah, who has set the stars for you, so that you may guide your course with their help through the darkness of the land and the sea. We have indeed detailed our signs for people who know. Rain, animals, men, mountains, various colors of mountains, etc. Why? أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ. Did I give you the citation on that one, last one? Quran, Surah 6, Ayah 97. The last one was Quran, Surah 6, Ayah 97. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجْنَا بِهِ ثَمَرَاتٍ مُخْتَلِفًا أَلْوَانُهَا وَمِنَ الْجِبَالِ جُدَدٌ بِيضٌ وَحُمْرٌ مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهَا وَغَرَابِيبُ سُودٍ وَمِنَ النَّاسِ وَالدَّوَابِّ وَالْأَنْعَامِ مُخْتَلِفًا أَلْوَانُهُ كَذَلِكَ إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. In Surah Fatir, Surah 35, and from 27 to 28, have you not seen that Allah causes water to fall from the sky? We go out and see the rain. We think about just covering ourselves. Have you not seen that Allah causes the water to fall from the sky, with which is produced fruit of various colors, from the same water, various colors and various states, and you put it in a dish there and you eat. This is apple, this is a grape, this is strawberry, this is banana, and the water that feeds them is the same. but different colors, different shapes, and different tastes. How many of us thought about this? How many? How many said, therefore, Alhamdulillah? How many we praised Allah and thought about worshipping Him better? From the simple things that we see around us. You don't need a lecturer. And in the mountains are tracts white and red of various shades of color, and black tense in hue, and of men and moving creatures, beasts, etc., and cattle, in like manners of various colors we see. It is only those who have knowledge among His slaves that fear Allah. Those who have knowledge and contemplate about this knowledge, they will be the ones who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Men with various colors and tongues. Why? وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And among His signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the difference of your languages and colors. Verily in that there are indeed signs for men of knowledge. This is in Surah 30, Ayah 22. The night goes, the night comes. The day goes, the night comes. Huh? In succession. Right? يُقَلِّبُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ. He tells you about things you see every day. يُقَلِّبُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِأُولِي الْأَبْصَارِ. In Surah An-Nur, which is Surah 24, Ayah 44. Allah causes the night and the day to succeed each other. Truly in these things, lesson for those who have insight. So, those therefore that you turn for, these gods that you turn for are created and are weak. And you set them as rivals with Allah, who had given you all of this, who had shown you all these signs and more. And He gives you some insight about those whom people had turned to. وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ ضَرًّا وَلَا نَفْعًا وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ مَوْتًا وَلَا حَيَاةً وَلَا نُشُورًا. Yet they have taken besides Him, besides Allah, other gods, who created nothing but are themselves created, and can neither hurt nor benefit themselves, and possess no power of causing death, nor of giving life, nor of raising the dead. These are the qualities. Raising the dead? But Jesus raised the dead. Isn't it that what you read before? Right? So how are you going to respond to this? How do we respond to this? They have no power, Allah says, of raising the dead. Jesus, peace be upon Him, raised the dead. But did He on His own? Who enabled Him to do so? Allah. Who gave Him the permission to do so? And who told Him to do so? Allah. You want to hear about this? It's better to. Because you quote these statements for your information. In Surah Al-Imran, which is Surah 3, 49, Ayah 49, speaking about Isa, about Jesus, peace be upon Him. وَرَسُولًا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أني قد جئتكم بآية من ربكم أني أخلق لكم من الطين كهيئة الطير فأنفخ فيه فيكون طيرا بإذن الله وأبرئ الأكمه والأبرص بإذن الله وأحيي الموتى بإذن الله. And we'll make Him, Jesus, a messenger to the children of Israel. To the children of Israel, remember, not a messenger to all mankind. This was the message of the Quran, trusted to whom? To Muhammad, peace be upon him, to all mankind. The message of Isa was limited to the children of Israel. And will make him, Jesus, a messenger to the children of Israel, saying, I have to come to you with a sign from your Rabb, in that I make for you out of clay, as it were, the figure of a bird, and breathe into it, and it becomes a bird, underline this now, by Allah's leave. By Allah's leave. And I heal him who was born blind, and the leper, and I bring the dead to life, underline now, by Allah's leave. Even in their books, which I don't want to go deeply into this, but just to touch on the surface, in Matthew 28:18, the power is given unto me, isn't it? I can of myself do nothing, isn't it? You heard this before? I don't want to go into that. Suffice is the Quran, okay? Now, all these gods, Allah, that these people turn to with a small g and worship and made them gods and gave them divinity, etc. Allah gives one thing of a parable or an example for us to really contemplate upon vis-a-vis these people and what they worship. Ya ayyuhan nas, ضرب مثل فاستمعوا له. إن الذين تدعون من دون الله لن يخلقوا ذبابا ولو اجتمعوا له وإن يسلبهم الذباب شيئا لا يستنقذوه منه ضعف الطالب والمطلوب. In Surah Al-Hajj, Ayah 73, which is Surah 22, verse 73. Listen to this. O mankind, a similitude has been coined, so listen to it carefully. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the translation of the meaning. Verily, those on whom you call besides Allah cannot create even a fly. Cannot create even a fly. Though they combine together for the purpose. Let them come and gather all their powers, so called. Try to create what? A fly. And if the fly should snatch away anything from them, they would have no power to release it from the fly. So weak are both the seeker, meaning who seeks other than Allah is weak, and the sought, meaning all those who consider themselves divine are weak. Both are weak. How much time I have? No. I'm not going to take the whole thing. I'll leave room for you. But how much time I have so that I know what to say here? خمس دقائق؟ خلاص؟ I got a signal from this, it's finished. طيب, we stop here because there is a lot, but some other time. We stop with this example, huh? And that's a nice and beautiful example.
Well, after hearing this lecture, I think it would be nice to have as many questions as possible, because I think the lecture is full of a lot of things to offer. So let's just go over this. How about if we just first start with the oral question? I mean, face-to-face questions. Wouldn't it be better? Somebody has got an oral question. I think that would be more appropriate now. Or else we'll just get into reading the questions here, which I hope I will have no difficulty in reading it. Can you just read it? Anybody has got oral question, face-to-face question? I don't know.
The first question says, who are the ones who will go to heaven? What are the characteristics? I picked up the first one. This is another good question here.
Okay, what's the best way in worshipping Allah? That's the first question. Let's go to this question. What's the best way in worshipping Allah?
There can be no best way to worship Allah except the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the evidence for this is the saying of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that the best of speech is the book of Allah, and the best of guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and that every innovated matter in religion is astray, and every astray, which is dalala means, is in hell. So the best way of following this deen, as Allah had chosen Muhammad, peace be upon him, لِيُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that he clearly demonstrates and show the people how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at it this way. Who told us to pray in this way? Take the Quran from the beginning to the end. Do you find a description of how we pray? Do we? We don't. Who taught us this? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And who was the one who said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي, pray as you had seen me praying. Who said this? Muhammad. Because his way of praying is the one which is accepted by whom? By Allah. Why? Because وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He doesn't speak of his own desires. He is only under inspiration from whom? From Allah. And the one who is inspired from Allah, his message is complete. His message is perfect. And there is no error in his message. Therefore, there is no better way than Muhammad's way. And that is the meaning of the second part of your declaration of Shahadatan. La ilaha illallah. There is no true God who deserves to be worshipped alone except Allah. And what? Muhammad Rasulullah. Meaning Muhammad is to be taken, to be followed in all acts of worship. He is the guide. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave you, ordered you to do, then take it and hold to it. And whatever he told you to stay away from, then abstain from it.
Okay, the second question, which is, I think it might be a little bit similar. Please define worship in detail. What is the effect of worship to true God, Allah, on a human being?
We didn't put that question aside, who's going to go to hell.
Yeah, don't worry about it. It's there.
So that you think we're cheating on you, just I will let you. See, I don't have water. Jazakallah. No water, no answers.
Please define
worship. Please define worship. Simple. Very simple, but profound. Worship is everything that Allah likes and loves, from the outward actions and the inward actions. Are there inward actions? Are there inward actions? Are there? Where is your intention? Where? Inside. How do you make dependence on Allah? Where? Where? On the surface of the moon or here? Inside. How do you make hope in Allah? Where? Inside. Inside where though? Heart. There is a piece of flesh in the body. If it is good, the rest of the body will be good. If it is bad, the rest of the body will be bad. And that is what? The heart. Who said this? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So worship is everything that Allah likes from the outward and word actions, but not according to X and Y and Z. Huh? Allah loves and likes. Allah will love and like worship according to X and Y and Z, or according to his doctrine. You see, the Christians went astray because they said, this is we pray. Some said, okay, I pray while I'm praying. Some said, while I'm walking, I'm praying. Huh? They invented ways of praying. They invented, because they didn't have the true knowledge about how to worship Allah. That's why they fell into mistakes, and serious mistakes, and therefore ended up in worshipping other than Allah. And this is something we'll give an example about for all these people who came to the fold of Islam. Not to forget our people who were born in Islam and continue to be on Islam. One time, one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ passed by a group of people in a mosque, and they were making dhikr, and dhikr is remembering Allah. Huh? But they were gathered in groups, and there is a group, and on each group there was a man standing by saying, say La ilaha illallah 100 times, say Allahu Akbar, you know, such and such, say. And the companion passed by this mosque, he saw this thing, he didn't feel good about it, something is wrong here. He went to a knowledgeable scholar and a great companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the name of Abdullah bin Mas'ud, and told him, this is what I saw in the mosque. He came rushing to the mosque, and he saw them making this act of worship, which is dhikr. It's an act of worship. But they were making it now on their own, the way, gathering in groups, and one leading them, saying such and such after me. He said, woe to you. These are the dishes of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just, you know, not broken, you know, meaning that he just passed us, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you are bringing something new, innovation in you. They said, oh, we only wanted good. Huh? And now, how many times of you here in lectures, somebody stands there from the audience, you see, we all believe in Allah, you worship Him like you want, we worship Him like we want, we all intend good, isn't it? Don't you hear this? So we can stay on each other. You hear that many times. But the point here that Abdullah bin Mas'ud made, how many who seek good, but they don't attain it. They don't attain it. Meaning that the good is in the way which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam described, and this is not a proper way of worship, making dhikr this way. And apply this hadith to every act of worship. If there is a clear proof from Quran and from hadith, from sunnah, which is authentic, then hold to it. Right? But if there isn't any proof or the saying of such and such without an evidence, then be careful.
Who are the ones who will go to hellfire, and what are their characteristics?
First of all, definitely, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no one can judge on any person who will go to hell except those whom Allah had determined will go to hell, and their characteristics are in the Quran or taught to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And on top of this list, those who commit shirk, worshipping other than Allah or setting up rivals with Him. إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. Verily Allah does not forgive those who commit shirk in Him or set up rivals with Him, but He may forgive anything else lesser, meaning than this sin, to whom He wishes. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that the kafirin are in hellfire. Those who disbelieve and reject Allah and the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and die on this, they are to hell. إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة ومأواه النار. Anyone who commits shirk in Allah, Jannah is forbidden for him, and his abode is the fire of hell. These are the characteristics of the fire of hell, to commit shirk. From the Muslims, no Muslim who utters the Tawheed and believes in Allah will end up eternally in hell. You understand? The Muslim committing sin, he's subject to that judgment of Allah. Allah may forgive him directly, or He may punish him to the time that Allah decides upon. Okay? But at the end, his time is where? In heaven. You understand this?
Dr. Saleh, you have said that Allah is able to do what He wants. I think more correctly, God is able to do everything and not only what He wants. That's a comment.
This is just going around the words, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anything He wants, He is able to do, certainly. He wants any matter, He will say it to it be, and it will be. And He is able to do anything, whatever it may be, and subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. There is nothing, there is no wrong in, in this.
Okay, Christian believe Jesus as the Son of God and not God as you think, because He said, I can of my own self do nothing. Please explain. Well, I think that's
Let me say Krishna's very I'm not God as you think, because he said, I cannot myself do nothing.
Christians believe Jesus was Son of God. Christians do? Do they say this? Do Christians say this? They say he is Son of God?
Yes.
But they said about five others too to be the Son of God. Right? So, I'm not making a joke. I'm saying serious things in the Bible that exists now. David was called Son of God. In Hanukkah, you open, also open, find some were called, others called, were firstborn too. Some were called firstborn. Israel was firstborn. So, I mean, which one was the Son of God according to such statements? So it cannot be reliable. It cannot be reliable. First of all, Allah is in need, in no need of any son or a wife, or as we gave some of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a big insult on Allah to say that he had taken children. I asked a priest one time in the States, a prominent priest in the Methodist Church. I told him, why you think, you know, Allah needs children and everything? His answer was to experience what man experiences. Allahu Akbar. To this deficiency they want to put Allah? Experience? Allah doesn't experience. He knew man before he created him. كيف هذا? And then the other thing they say, the Christians, is, well, is to shed the blood of his only son for the sacrifice and forgiveness of the sins of the people and etc. And then, you know, according to the Bible itself, their statements contradict this. And I said, I don't want to go through that too much, but I'll give you a briefing. Eloha, Eloha, why you had forsaken me? Huh? Had he known that he is going to be sacrificed for the sake of humanity, he shouldn't have complained. He shouldn't have asked the help. Eloha, Eloha, why you had forsaken me? Accusing him even of forsaking him? How could God, Jesus, God, you know, accuse God and seeking help from God? Right? And telling him why you had forsaken me. And these things do not stand. These are not strong things. The Bible, by the way, the Bible, the gospel that was given to Isa alayhi salam, is a true revelation from Allah in its intact form. So was the Torah that was revealed to Musa alayhi salam. But the Bibles or Bible that exists today is compromised of falsehood and truth. Okay? Falsehood and truth. But the gravest and most terrible falsehood in it is setting up rivals with Allah in the name of Jesus and others. And this is not accepted in Islam. That's why Allah abrogated everything that is in the Bible and made the Quran supersede and preserve this Quran from any kind of alteration. It is perfect. It's the word of Allah. No contradiction whatsoever you can find in it.
Okay, this question is a little bit vague, but I hope to the general... Okay, we know that nothing is impossible to Allah. Now, why is it that he still uses Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all, etc., just to testify that he is the one we worship? Okay. Why he still use Muhammad just to write the Quran, not just by himself? Why? You know, I mean, you got it. I think it's clear. Why cannot he depend on himself instead of just using Muhammad and Jesus and Moses?
Allah sends messengers. This is part of his mercy upon us all. From ourselves, we can relate to them. And we know that they are men like us. That they will die. And that we end up not worshipping them. Right? We take their message. He had chosen from amongst his creation these people, these men, and trusted them with revelation to relate to us how to worship him. Do you want God to come down on earth so that you worship him? Do you want God to walk on earth, as you may start thinking or imagining, in order to worship him? Who are we anyway? He owns us. He owns us. But this is part of the arrogance of man. This is part of the arrogance of man. The message comes to him clear and vivid from people like him with great morality and chosen by Allah to deliver the message how to worship him, how to attain salvation, and he keeps questioning. And he keeps throwing rejection at these messengers. Allah had chosen messengers and the messengers were rejected. And they were rejected in many cases. But part of his mercy, he brought guidance to us in many ways. Part of this through messengers. Part of this through revelation. Part of this through the signs in ourselves. Part of this through the signs in the universe surrounding us. All of this, this is a challenge for man. And a test and trial for man. So that he comes and comes wholeheartedly to his Creator. And does not act arrogantly and turn away. And having men to relate to is much easier. It's much more easier than to relate, as you may think, to God walking on earth, quote unquote.
Okay. You've mentioned, respected doctor, you've mentioned in the beginning of your speech that in the chapter number 22, verse 21, that there is no God besides Allah. Also, Christians believe that there is only one God. Also, Christians believe that this one God is the Creator. Would you please elaborate on that?
Okay, but we always ask the Christians the same question. We all believe in one God being the Creator, being the Sustainer, being the Provider. We agree on these terms in the very beginning of the talk. And this is good. This is good. Because sometimes you may be dealing with someone who's atheist, huh? Who denies completely the existence of God, right? He doesn't accept him as the Creator, isn't it? An atheist, right? But if you deal with the people of the book, meaning Christians and all Jews, they accept this fact that God is the Creator. But then when you throw a little bit of more questioning and try to figure out what kind of attributes this God that they think of, then you will end up finding that they committed shirk. They had dignified or did not dignify, I'm sorry, they did not dignify Allah properly. And the God they are worshipping is associated with Isa. Isn't it? That Isa is the salvation way. Whether some of them take him as God or an intermediate, both are wrong. You see the point? And that's why you differ with them on this issue. Because this is the issue between hell and heaven. So why should we take the path of hell? If they die on this, they're going to go to hell. Anyone who dies, I mean not only Christians, a Muslim who dies committing shirk with Allah, right, and dies on this, and knowingly and committing this and practicing this, and dies on this, and loves it and likes it, etc., what is La ilaha illallah going to benefit him? It's not going to benefit him. You understand this point? So this is something universal. It is not only to the Christians. Anyone who says we believe in God, you may find a Hindu, he says, we believe in God. But his God may be 3 million gods united in one tree or in one river or in something. Isn't it? Isn't it? And some had taken Buddha to be God. And Buddha sleeps and eats and... Huh? And he had a wife. And he had a son. You understand what I'm saying? Go back to the issue. What attributes? Your gods are all created. Your gods are all created. Including Jesus, peace be upon
you. Okay, we seem to have two questions here of two people. I think they have been communicating with the same signal. Anyway, the questions speak about if Adam and Eve, okay, were the the first ancestors. Okay, why would you have black and white and all these colors? I mean, I don't know how these people must have telepathy going around them.
Why don't you walk naked in the streets? Huh? Why you put clothes on? For a purpose, isn't it? Right? There's a purpose. Isn't it? You accept for yourself a purpose, or you don't. When you do something. Right? And do you think your Creator does things in vain? Does he? Or there is wisdom behind everything he does? In our tongues, in our colors, in the vegetables, colors, in the fruits, and etc. There are signs for you to contemplate. Allahu Akbar. When I see somebody who is Chinese, who is Vietnamese, who is Ethiopian, who is American from the South, with different complexities, with different features, and you see an Arab in front of you with different complexities and features, what do you think? Don't you need to glorify the one who created all these various? Allahu Akbar, ya. These are signs for us, and we only come to know each other. That's the only thing. And he says in the Quran, إِنَّا أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Among all these creatures, the best in the sight of Allah are those who are most fearful of Allah. Black, white, yellow, orange. Huh?
Okay, that I've been given the signal that should be the last question, even though I would like to really continue. Okay. What's the difference between Jesus and Muhammad? This is a routine question that we get here. And what are the duties given, or what is the duties of this? Okay, what are the duties given to these two messengers, basically?
Number one, both are messengers of Allah. Second, both are honorable messengers in the sight of Allah. We're not talking about difference, huh? We're talking about commonalities. And with distinction, each was sent for a purpose limited in one sense, and common in another sense. Common in the essence of it. The message is the same. O Israel, the Lord, my Lord and your Lord is one, worship Him. Huh? You think this is not in the Quran? It's in the Quran. إِنَّ اللَّهَ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُوهُ. Calling the children of Israel, my Lord, my Rabb, and your Rabb is the same. Worship Him alone. Again. This was to the children of Israel. The major distinction, therefore, lies here in the fact that Isa alayhi salam was giving the message of Islam, of submission to Allah, to the children of Israel. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's message, after what happened to these messages before, the changes and the alterations, etc., Muhammad, peace be upon him, Allah trusted him with a new verse, universal message to all mankind. And that is the Quran. No alterations, no modifications. And this was a great honor to the last messenger whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen. Secondly, there were other distinctions. Isa alayhi salam, at his time, people believed in miracles very much. They believed very much in miracles. So he had been given a great deal of miracles at his time. And in order to what? To bring the attention to the people through miracles itself, who is the one who had given him this power? And to relate to Allah, his creator, so that Allah be worshipped alone amongst his nation. Now, Isa alayhi salam's death, or quote unquote, as the Christians say, was a miracle in itself. Not the death, but the end, quote unquote, on earth. Alright? I'm using very cautiously these terms, huh? Because I'm trying to get your thinking to what the Christians are saying. In his end on earth, right? Isa was a sign. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifted him up and saved him from the great plots that were done to kill him and to finish him by the Jews and those who rejected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In that there was a great, great honor to the Prophet Isa alayhi salam, and Allah had honored him by lifting him up to him. Up to him, alive. And that Isa alayhi salam will come down before the end of the world. And he will descend, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained, in Damascus. And here comes another point, a commonality. When he descends to Damascus, or in the city of Damascus, carried by two angels, the Muslim Imam will introduce him to lead the prayer. And Isa alayhi salam will refuse. And he says, look, two statements. And both are authentic in Sahih Muslim, in the book of Muslim, of Hadith. One, I am but a follower of the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Meaning I am only a follower of Islam. You be the leader to lead the prayer. I am only a follower. The second, he said, I came to rule by the book and sunnah. I came to rule by the book and sunnah. A commonality and continuity of the same message. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, duty is very much targeted to the whole world. The essence of the message is the same. The great distinction is in the universality of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to all mankind. Jesus, peace be upon him, message was limited. Musa's message was limited to the children of Israel. These are the two major, or this is the major distinction between these two great prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What
else? Okay, that's after that. I would like just to thank the doctor, and may Allah reward him for his effort and for that enlightening lecture that we all have benefited from. And with that, I would like to say the supplication: Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullah khair. Jazakumullah khair.